This is a 16-inch M3 Max MacBook Pro, and I've been daily driving it as my main DaVinci Resolve workstation for about 2 months now. I have switched to it from my pretty beefy but not completely high-end PC, and I'm here to answer one simple question. Is this the best computer you can buy for DaVinci Resolve right now? Stay tuned to find out my verdict, but I just want to preface this by saying that I'm not a tech reviewer. I bought both of these computers with my own money as a professional, and I gained nothing by making this comparison. This is a real user review, and I'm making it because I've watched a bunch of M series Mac reviews and none of them answered my specific set of questions. First of all, I'm only interested in real world performance and not synthetic benchmarks. And I don't care how well ProRes RAW runs in Final Cut, because that's not my workflow. My post-production tool of choice is DaVinci Resolve, and I mostly work with H.264 files from Sony cameras. Second, when discussing video applications, most reviewers focus solely on rendering performance, because that's an easily replicable test that you can use for benchmarking. But I, and I bet most other editors and colorists out there, don't really care about rendering times. A video taking 20 or 15 minutes to render really has no bearing on me, because I won't be sitting there watching the progress bar anyway. What matters most of all to me is timeline performance and general responsiveness and stability of the program, because that's the stuff where I can gain or lose the most amount of time. And I'm at a point where time is more valuable than money, so if I can pay a little extra to make my workflow faster and easier, that's money well spent in my book. And speaking of money, let's quickly run through the rationale of how I configured this machine. First of all, I've never even considered anything other than a Mac, simply because it has two media engines, and that has way more performance impact on video editing than core count, because it practically doubles the speed of any encode-decode tasks. I could have just as easily gone for the so-called binned version of M3 Max without losing that much editing performance. But I decided to max out to exclude even the possibility of buyer's remorse. I also think that in terms of resale value, the maxed out chip is gonna hold its value better. Plus, I wanted to play some Baldur's Gate 3, and that's the stuff where you can really see those extra GPU cores at work. With the full M3 Max, you also get, or should I say forced to get, 48 gigs of shared memory, which I think is a sweet spot between 32 and 64 gigs for DaVinci Resolve. When it comes to onboard storage, I went with 4 TB, because anything less seemed like asking for trouble. A decently sized video project for me is about 1 to 2 TB, so with 4 TB I can live a dongle-free life and edit it locally and still have a space for cache and programs and my asset libraries. But I'm not blind to the fact that Apple obscenely overcharges for storage. It's a racket, no other way to put it. Anyway, back to the specs, going with the 16-inch model also was a no-brainer for me. Mind you, I bought this laptop as a desktop replacement, and I wanted all the screen space I could get. Plus, you get bigger battery and better heat dissipation on the 16-inch model. And it's still fairly small and portable. Frankly, if Apple sold a 20-inch laptop, I would buy a 20-inch laptop. People who are saying this laptop is big and heavy are crazy and have no frame of reference. I used to have a 17-inch Asus gaming laptop with a discrete GPU. That thing was freaking massive. It looked like a stealth bomber and sounded like a stealth bomber. It weighed 3.5 kilos and had a power brick the size of my head, which you had to carry around with you because that thing had like 1 hour battery life. And yet it was still a weak and castrated version of a desktop PC. This, however, is the thinnest and lightest professional computer that I've ever held in my hand or even seen. And it gives that 20 kilo monstrosity over there a run for its money, all while staying cool and virtually silent and running on battery all day. Just considering how much power I hold here in the palm of my hand makes me think how spoiled we are with technology today. What a time to be alive. So in total, this configuration stacks up to $5,000, but you can easily get virtually the same editing performance by going with the binned M3 Max chip and 1 TB of storage. That will be $3,500, which is a number a bit easier to digest, but be prepared for dongle life and don't expect great performance in 3D applications. Alright, with all of that out of the way, let's get to the tests. Here are the specs of my PC. It's a last gen, but still what I would consider to be a lower high-end machine. I did my best to make this comparison as fair as possible, so same version of DaVinci, same exact project database, same plugins, same everything. Latest drivers and updates, and both projects are running from the same speed NVMe SSD. Both computers have the render cache turned off and proxies disabled. It's a 1080p timeline with 4K output and the files are H.264, my usual workflow. I'll skip over basic editing because both machines perform flawlessly when it comes to just cutting stuff on a timeline or even with basic color correction. Instead, let's look at this heavily graded short film project, which has a lot of effects and plugins on both the video and audio tracks. Overall timeline performance is about the same on both machines, with a slight edge towards Mac. It's a bit more responsive to scrolling and rippling edits. It's also faster to start playback and more consistent about playing out all the frames instead of pausing, buffering and skipping forward. But the overall difference is small, and the key takeaway here is that neither machine can play out this timeline in real time. And I wouldn't expect it to because we have proxies disabled and render cache turned off. But let's look at this clip. It has both noise reduction and Dehancer Pro film emulation, both very resource intensive effects that can really bog down your system. And both computers play this 25p clip at about 9 to 10 frames a second, so no real difference there. This test just goes to show that you shouldn't expect any miracles. Stuff that would bog down the PC also bogs down the Mac. The only exception would be something like H.265, which enjoys hardware acceleration on the Mac. Making ProRes proxies will also improve the editing speed on the Mac, but I wanted to keep a level playing field for this test. So for timeline performance, it's a draw, with a slight edge towards Mac for responsiveness. Timeline switching is a bane of my existence. I rely on it heavily for pancake editing and non-destructive workflows, which by the way I made a video about right here. The bigger and more complex a project gets, the longer it takes to switch timelines. In a late stage big project with lots of effects and heavy color grading, it can take up to a minute to switch timelines, which is crazy. And of course, on the PC, DaVinci Resolve crashed during timeline switch, which happens to me at least once every session. I had high hopes that Mac would improve this situation, but alas, no such luck. Switching timelines still takes forever, but at least Mac doesn't crash. This result was especially frustrating to me, and it makes me think that it's not a computer issue, but a DaVinci Resolve issue, which Blackmagic Designs should take a look at ASAP. Copy-pasting between timelines is a basic editing operation, and it needs to work instantly. Always look on the right side of life. Stabilizing clips is a common editing task, and it's the first area where Mac is just way ahead of the PC. It stabilizes clips almost 4 times faster than the PC, and same applies to mask tracking, which is essentially the same operation. This is cool to have, but not likely to save me a bunch of time, because I usually stabilize only the short parts of clips. And whether they take a second or a quarter second to stabilize doesn't really move the needle for me. Magic Mask is one of those newer DaVinci Resolve features that sounds great on paper but performs so terribly that I almost never use it. So I was curious to test it on a Mac, and I was surprised to find that it works even slower on a Mac than it does on PC. This result is somewhat puzzling to me because I expected Mac to vastly outperform here. Since Magic Mask is a tool based on machine learning, I thought it would take advantage of the neural engine that is on the Apple's chip. Because, for example, in Adobe Lightroom, every AI-based tool works blazingly fast on the M3 Mac. Not sure what's going on here, but I guess I'll just continue to not use Magic Mask. Now, like I said in the intro, editing speeds are not of vital importance to me, but I was still curious to see how these machines stack up. And it turned out that rendering speed-wise, again, these machines are pretty close to each other. Mac took 17 minutes to render out this effects-heavy 10-minute short film in 4K, while PC took 16 minutes. So a slight advantage to the PC, but it is completely overshadowed by the fact that it took 2 attempts, because on the first attempt the render crashed due to a GPU driver error. And I swear, I'm not making this stuff up. DaVinci on PC crashes all of the time. And before you go into couch analyst mode, no, this problem is not on my end. It's been like that for years, on different computers, different versions, different everything. That's just the reality of PC life. Nothing is ever optimized for your machine, because that's virtually impossible. There are as many PC configurations out there as there are people. And something is bound to break somewhere. Suffice to say that in just 2 hours of testing for this video, DaVinci on PC crashed twice, while Mac didn't crash once in 2 months that I've been daily driving it as my work machine. And this has nothing to do with hardware specs or raw computing power. I've read time and time again that DaVinci Resolve is developed first and foremost for Macs, but I didn't want to believe it. Seemed too much like fanboy talk. But my own testing proves it to be true. Alright, so what's my verdict? I'll be completely honest with you. Coming from an already pretty beefy PC, I wasn't blown away by the performance. It's not to say that it's bad or anything, it just didn't exceed my expectations, which were built up by all this crazy hype surrounding M-Series Macs. And if you take price-to-performance ratio into account, these Macs look like a bad deal on paper. This 16-inch M3 Max MacBook Pro with 4 TB of storage cost me $5,000, which makes it a very, very expensive computer. For $5,000, you can build a faster high-end gaming PC and still have money for a very nice OLED 4K monitor. So if all you care about is raw computing power per dollar, PC is still unbeatable. But it's not that simple. At this point in my life, I'm way more interested in the day-to-day experience of actually using the thing than I care about some theoretical top-end performance. And by this qualitative metric, MacBook Pro is just a better overall experience. Not just for DaVinci Resolve, but especially for DaVinci Resolve. So not only am I not disappointed, I'm actually really happy that I made the switch. It turned out to be more of a lateral move than an upgrade, because I didn't get any meaningful jumps in terms of workflow speed, but there were major improvements in quality of life realm. First of all, I've gained in stability and reliability, which are of utmost importance to me. Just that peace of mind alone is already worth it. But other than that, it's a thin and light laptop that is as powerful as a desktop PC, but is portable, has an all-day battery life, and doesn't spew out a bunch of heat and noise like this machine does. Now I can work from any room in my home, or laying in bed, or I can take it to a cafe, or a shoot, or a client meeting or something, and I can do all of the same stuff that I could previously do only chained to the desk. A laptop used to be a compromise. You used to have to sacrifice performance to gain portability, but no more. This machine has both in spades. Plus, there's a dozen small things to love about it. like the fast Thunderbolt 4 ports, built-in SD reader, AirDrop, which is awesome, ProRes rendering, amazing trackpad, great set of speakers, nice HDR screen, and just the overall build quality and clean user interface. It's hard to put into words or prove, but Mac is just so much nicer to use. And it kind of hurts to admit it as a lifetime PC guy. I've just reset my PC to put it on sale, and for the first time I saw what default Windows 11 experience looks like. And man, what a fucking mess, just awful. Bloated with crapware, riddled with widgets and pop-ups, so poorly designed and a complete privacy nightmare to boot. I'm not saying that macOS is perfect by any means, but man, it's so much cleaner and nicer to use than Windows. So, just to bring it all down to a final conclusion, is this the best machine you can currently buy for DaVinci Resolve? It would seem that on paper the answer is no. The only caveat is, life isn't on paper. Thanks for watching.